his BFL debut. Dave, good evening, everybody. Welcome to the YouTube channel portion of BFL 74. I'm Craig Nielsen alongside of David Perron. This is Jake Freeman that you're seeing here. He is taking on Liam Arthur in our first fight of the undercard, Dave.
Yeah, that's right. On one of the most stacked cards we've ever had here in BFL history. This card is the card that just keeps giving. It keeps getting better and better and better. So just get ready for some wild action here as we're just getting started. As we see Jake Freeman hugging his corner goodbye and getting ready to get in there and kick things off for us tonight.
Yes, Freeman is a Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu brown belt. Won his first and only fight by decision at a other local fight promotion back in May of this year. 26 years old, training for 7 years in Jiu-Jitsu. On and off with kickboxing for about 3 years. Got serious about MMA about 2 years ago.
Yeah, he fought not too long ago on a Mamba card back in May. I fought another TriStar guard, so tonight he's actually fighting the teammate of somebody he fought previously, and the last fight went pretty well for him, so he won all three rounds, took him down at will, and he felt like he fully controlled the fight. So that's a good confidence builder as you roll into your second fight. Maybe that fight wasn't actually on record, but still, it's his technically second, but regardless, this one's live right in front of our eyes, and it should be a good one.
Yeah, Freeman shared his thoughts about his opponent, Liam Arthur, who's 1-1, thinks he matches up well against Arthur, and he's not a big fan of Arthur's takedown.
Yeah, we just...
Arthur's takedown defense, rather. So he believes he's going to be able to take down his opponent rather easily in this contest.
And we can see in his corner there, the ghost Christian Tremaine, who was... supposed to be on this fight, but we had a couple fights fall through, unfortunately, but still a lot of depth to it still, but always unfortunate when we lose some fights. All right.
Yeah, Jake Freeman thinks grappling is definitely his strength. He's been working on his striking. As a young fighter, you often will find out, you know, fighters come from a certain base and, you know, they might have something that they need to bring up to other parts of their game. And so he's been focused on the striking as we see Liam Arthur. This is his second appearance in Battlefield.
Coming out, seeming pretty relaxed there. A nice slow jam. His last loss was a while back against Daniel Abdur back in July via unanimous decision, you know. And he won his other fight pre-COVID via RNC, and he feels confident in all aspects of the game. You can see him with his cornerman there as he gets greased up. He's working with there. You see Coach Cajun and Sean. He's been specifically working on his ground game. He's currently the 8th ranked BFL featherweight fighter. And yeah, looking to stay busy, you know. A lot of people just after the COVID, the forced layoff, they're just eager to get in there, and that's why we've been lucky enough to have tons and tons of fights come through because everybody just has been dying to get in there, and now we have the opportunity to.
Yeah, I was talking before the fight about the mental aspect of the fight game. He said the one thing he took out of his last fight is he just needs to come in a little bit more confident. He needs to have that sort of mental base that he can do this, that he's confident, and we'll see what he brings in the cage tonight.
100%, yeah. Confidence is a huge factor in fighting that most people may not think about when you're just watching or you're a casual fan, but the confident fighter is a dangerous fighter, and that usually makes a difference between being in the win column and the lose column here as we look at
all
the
right.
Stats here.
Yeah, the BFL odds brought to you by Grindhouse Athletics, Vancouver's premier strength and conditioning facility. Arthur Freeman. Jake Freeman is the favorite in this one, 60 to 40. It is Freeman with the edge in submissions and wrestling. There, we don't know his grit of striking, so we'll see about that. But he is your favorite heading into this one. All right, let's get these fighters introduced. Inside the cage we go. Here he is, Ryan Ventura.
Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the Harbor Event and Convention Center in Vancouver, BC, as the Battlefield Fight League presents BFL 74. Live and exclusively on UFC Fight Pass. This event is sanctioned by the British Columbia Athletic Commissioner. Our commissioner is Kelly Gilday. Our judges for this evening, Jake Maxim, Jason Dera, and Patrick Gates. And our referees for this evening are John Cooper, Mitch Cadlick, and Sal Ram. This next fight is in the BFL featherweight division, scheduled for three 3-minute rounds. Introducing first, the fighter in the blue corner. This BJJ brown belt has a record of 1 win, no losses. Making his BFL debut, representing Revolution Martial Arts and Fitness in Langley, BC, here is Chick Freeman. And now introducing his opponent in the red corner. This man has a record of 1 win, 1 loss. Making his second BFL appearance, representing TriStar MMA in Burnaby, BC, he is your current number 8 ranked BFL amateur featherweight fighter. Here is Liam Arthur. And your man in charge of the action is Sal Ram.
All right, Sal Ram is the referee. This one's scheduled for 3 3-minute rounds in the amateur featherweight division here in BFL. And Dave, let's hope it's a good one to kick things off tonight here at BFL 74. As you see Arthur, he is in the blue trunks. It is Freeman in the red trunks. They sort of switched corner colors with their trunks. Freeman's in the blue corner with the red trunks. Arthur in the red corner with the blue trunks.
Right.
If that doesn't confuse you enough.
Correct. Freedom making his BFL his BFL debut and his second fight. And right away, Arthur lands a nice lead hook there. And Freeman retaliates. A nice cross. Really trying to set up that 1-2. Oh, aggressive. Oh, nice hook.
Both guys just content to stand in front of each other here.
Yeah, both guys exchange solid hooks there. Not afraid to just get in the puck and get busy. Nice job by Freeman.
A good combo from Freeman. Now he looks for the takedown. Nice takedown defense from Arthur.
Nice sprawl, good neck control. Very nice by Arthur there. Very comfortable there, doing all the right things.
Yeah,
we
said off the top, Freeman thought he was... Arthur's takedown defense wasn't that good, but it looked pretty good right there as Arthur looking to take the back there. Nice. Gives that up. Now he looks for it again.
Nice spin attack attempt by Arthur, but good defense by Freeman. And then Liam ending up in a good position here. On his back against the cage, this is good. Forces his opponent to bear his weight and wear him down slowly here as he listens to his corner. Good defense by Freeman there, controlling the arm, trying to shake him off. This is good for him. If he could just throw Arthur to his back there, but Arthur being pretty sticky on top, but this is good.
This is good for Freeman now. Now it's Freeman with the back of Arthur. Now he's looking for the rear naked choke.
He gets both hooks in, locks in the body triangle. Oh, wow, great transition.
Yeah, halfway through here, round number one, a good position now for Freeman as he reverses nicely.
Yeah, that was slick. And his prediction for the fight was winning by second round, but it was by RNC rear naked choke, which he is trying to set up right here in front of her eyes here. Body triangle control here is gonna be very hard for Arthur to slide out of, so that was a very quick transition to the back into a dominant position for Freeman here.
Yeah, Freeman just seemed to be able, Dave, just he slid Arthur off the top a little bit, kind of.
Oh, look, he's attacking the neck here. This is still okay. He's not under the chin. But yeah, the quickness that he was able to just take his back and get both hooks in really shows his skills as a jiu-jitsu artist there.
Look at that body triangle there.
Yeah, that's tight.
That's locked in there.
He's got 45 seconds to go to work here. He's going to try and control an arm and get his arm under the chin, and if not, he's just going to squeeze on that body, try and tire him out, get some wind out of his lungs, and get him drained for the second round here. But great turn of events here from Freeman, who went from a bad position to an excellent one for, oh, there we go. Now he's attacking the neck. Good defense by Arthur there. Staying calm in there, controlling the hands, doing the right things. It's very difficult to get that body triangle off of you when you're in that position. You just can't panic, got to be calm.
Really a tale of two different halves of this first round. They started standing, exchanging some blows. It was Arthur with the early takedown attempt there, and then looking to get the back, and now it's Freeman for the last minute 30 here. He's been looking good, and you have to think that's going to end up being a nice round for Jake Freeman.
Yeah, you can see where he's very comfortable there. He opted for the...
All right, the corner cam brought to you by Grindhouse Athletics, Vancouver's premier strength and condition facility. Let's see what the corner of Liam Arthur is saying.
Punch your way into the takedown. This is your round now. This is your round. All right? Okay. Whoop this guy's fucking ass.
Okay.
Knock him the fuck out in this round.
All right, second round. Go.
All right, here's a replay.
This was near the beginning of the round when they were both standing.
This is a transition here. We're not going to see it, unfortunately. Right there. Couple shots, hook for hook. Pretty even exchange, I would say, on the feet. And then as soon as Freeman took the back there.
All right, action, live action here in round number two.
Ooh, nice body shot.
Oh, nice right hand there from Freeman.
Oh, nice lead hook by Arthur. Really not shy, just coming in forward, coming in hot. Great aggression by Arthur.
Yeah, Freeman looking for that big right. Now they...
Yeah, Freeman's doing a good job just trying to keeping his opponent at bay with that 1-2, and he's got a pretty strong hook that's landed more than a few times. So Arthur's going to try and get the takedown here. Battle for position, pretty even here. Good head position and pressure by Arthur.
Yeah, I see that Liam Arthur probably trying to get that right hand underneath, get the double underhooks, but good defense from Freeman.
Yeah.
So he eats a shot there. Nice right hand from Liam Arthur up against the cage.
Let's see Freeman looking up, listening to the Coltrane in his corner, telling him to control his wrist. Because right now, if he's not controlling his wrist, Arthur's able to land nice shots. Nice knee there by
Arthur.
Oh,
yeah. A couple of nice knees from Liam Arthur. Yeah, both these guys.
Reversal here.
The men that are speaking into their ears right now, both their coaches, the guys that are telling them what to do right now, both have fought fights in the UFC.
That's right.
Talking about Kajan Johnson in the corner of Liam Arthur, Cole Smith in the corner of Jake Freeman.
And now Freeman attempting a takedown here, trying to clasp his wrist, pull his leg off of the ground just like that. Good defense by Arthur. Keeps his balance, jumping on one leg and still landing some shots there. Good job. Relentless is Freeman. He's really going to try and get it. He's committed so far. He's going to really try to get that takedown, but great defense by Arthur here, using the cage to stay up on one leg here and controlling the left arm of Freeman.
Under a minute to go here in round number two. Very as they separate.
Nice defense by Arthur there, forcing Freeman to give up on that takedown attempt. Back to the feet we go. Nice.
The striking so far has been fairly even. Both guys landing. That was a nice left from Arthur, followed by a right from Arthur.
Yeah. A lot of power on the lead hand of Arthur with that lead hook. And Freeman shooting for that takedown from a distance, but still gets in there. Nice. And now he's going to try to progress to the back. Good defense by Arthur. There we go. Around and around we go here. And then Arthur using the cage to prevent Freeman from taking his back as he did in the first round here. Very evenly matched second round here so far. Both guys even on the feet, even against the cage. This is anyone's round so far. We got about 10 seconds left here. Oh, nice knee, spin around knee by Arthur. Oh, knee for knee.
Oh, damn. And one of them.
That looked like it hurt.
Yeah.
Just at the end of the round here, I wonder, there's probably like 1 or 2 seconds left.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, we're just going to wait for, I think, Arthur to recover, Dave, and then pretty much as soon as he stands up,
yeah,
we're going to get the end of the round here. All right, here we go. This is...
They were going knee for knee.
There you go. Oh, oh.
They both ate one.
Oh, they both looked like they landed.
Yeah, they did. But the jock strap doesn't always do its job.
Exactly. And obviously, Arthur, a little bit more the worse for wear here. So they both go down south.
Yeah, I'm pretty sure it's like the end of the round here.
Right at the same time. Wow, yeah.
Just missing the bell here.
Yeah, and I think we're just going to... Oh, we've got time for probably... Yeah, there you go, the bell.
Now
the horn.
Now you get a break. Double break. That's good for the cardio. You guys will be okay with that as we are listening to the corners before the third and final round.
All right. The quarter cam brought to you by Grindhouse Athletics, Vancouver's premier strength and conditioning facility. Here we have Kajan Johnson talking to Liam Arthur.
Very good. Don't forget to talk to him. You need the body of working.
Yeah.
Okay, when you peel out,
yeah.
Okay, break off.
Okay.
Peel off, break out. Sorry, peel out, break off, and then throw your shot.
Okay,
you're getting caught in a reel. He's re-entangling you. Get a little further away before you hit him.
Okay.
This is your round. Okay, it's one and one. This round
yes,
takes it. Okay?
Yes, sir.
Fuck him up. Okay, it. Knock him out. Knock him out.
Okay.
All right, Liam Arthur back ready to go for the third and final round here at our first fight of the night at BFL 74. And there is Jake Freeman. They touch gloves at the center and off they go. And Dave, now, this third and final round could be the decider.
Very close. Both guys very even on the feet. Similar skill sets so far. Arthur tends to be more of the offensive striker, and nice counter 1-2s by Freeman, doing a good job keeping his distance there. Seems to be more of a counter striker, but both guys landing. Nice kick by Arthur. Oh, nice cross that lands by Freeman there.
Another low kick from Arthur.
Yeah, that's not a bad strategy. That adds up. A nice
right hand from Arthur Lance.
Mm-hmm. Ooh.
Body shot and then a counter by Freeman. And look, Freeman looking for that trip, doesn't get it. Up against the cage they go once again. And a nice knee from Liam Arthur.
Yeah.
And he separates. And now he's throwing a left and a right.
Good aggression by Arthur, but nice counter shots by Freeman there.
And there he's looking for that low kick again as Liam Arthur. Nice left from Arthur.
Both guys landing those stiff jabs. Oh, nice. Nice duck there by Arthur. Ooh. Faking the shot. Trying to get that takedown. Freeman would be happy to get his opponent to the ground there, but great defense by Arthur. Not getting too easy here.
Halfway through the third and final round now.
Good D by Arthur here.
Freeman desperately looking for that takedown.
Be great for him to get him down and finish the round on top. A minute 10 left here in the final round. Nice trip. Oh, great defense. And luckily for Arthur, the cage was there to help him out there. It was good. Now he ends up in a good position here. A minute left in the third round. He's happy to, oh, nice.
Oh, both guys landing in that exchange. Left lands from Arthur.
Oh.
And now it's Freeman looking for the double.
Oh, great hits by Arthur. Man, that's
can't quite get the takedown. Now he's got it. But can Arthur get back up to his feet?
35. Oh, now this is good for Jake Freeman here. Final 30 seconds. He's got two hooks in. He's going to attack the neck, try and go down. Wow. He's going to want to hurry up here. He's got 20 seconds left, which was a pretty solid third round for Liam Arthur.
Arthur turn back into him, and he does. He's able to.
Oh, nice.
Left lands.
Great stiff jab by Arthur.
Oh, nice right hand from Freeman. Now it's a right from Arthur.
Both guys just standing in the phone booth. Ooh, shot for shot.
And there you go. Shot for shot right up until the end of the fight.
Yeah, great fight. Great matchup. Both guys had their moment there. Close fight.
That is a very tough one to score. And we will go to the judges' scorecards. You see Jake Freeman there with Cole Smith, the ghost, Christian Tremaine. Let's have a look at, I believe this is third round action now. We're exchanging on the feet. This is a
great sprawl by Arthur here.
Yes, Freeman goes for that single.
Nice. Almost and, had it.
Oh. And then that was the end of the second round, or the first round, rather. Some dirty boxing in tight from Liam Arthur.
Off the cage, yeah. That was a good sequence for him.
Looks for the body shot there.
Stiff job. That one landed quite a few times. Definitely not afraid to engage, both guys. in the pocket, throwing some shots there.
Yeah, both guys took, both guys landed. Jake Freeman's best round, probably the first.
Yeah, good pressure throughout the fight for Arthur as well.
Okay. This decision brought to you by Red One Casting, Canada's number one sports casting company. Inside the cage, we go to make it official. Here he is, Ryan Ventura.
Ladies and gentlemen, after three rounds, we go to the judges' decision. All three judges have scored this fight 29-28 for your winner by unanimous decision. The fighter in the red corner, Liam Arthur.
Yeah, so there you go, Dave. I think probably it was 29-28 for a reason. I think probably all three gave round one to Jake Freeman. But then Liam Arthur was just a little bit more aggressive, especially on his feet in the second and third round. Well, that's what I saw.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, I would agree with that. That was really close, unanimous. Definitely that's how I saw it. First round to Freeman and the last two to the winner here. He's going to be happy with that. He never laid off the gas pedal. He had a good aggression throughout the fight there. And the key to his victory was really sprawling and preventing those takedowns, because we saw what Freeman could do when he got his back. So he did a really good job sprawling, getting his hips back. And that's really what allowed him to come out on top of this one.
Well, a fun fight to start the night here at BFL 74. Of course, we'll remind everybody that's watching on our YouTube channel right now, 7:30 p.m. Pacific, 10:30 p.m. Eastern time, we will be live on UFC Fight Pass. And Dave, man, what a card we've got. The main event for the BFL Super Welterweight Championship. It is the champ, Dejan Kyhich, who takes on all comers. And boy,
That's a good one.
What a fighter he's got coming in tonight in JC Jamas. And this guy, he's a bare-knuckle boxing veteran. He's fought in Bellator before. He's going to give the champion all he can handle. And then
8-time world champion in jiu-jitsu. Don't forget that.
Oh, absolutely. He's the leg lock monster. So, wow, that's going to be a lot of fun. That one coming up a little bit later in the night, like I said, right at the end of our pay-per-view portion, or rather our UFC Fight Pass portion. All right. Here we have Connor Sutton coming to the cage for fight number two of BFL 74. Connor Sutton making his BFL debut, MMA debut. He's coming in. His record is fresh and clean at 0-0.
Fresh and clean.
He's 25 years old, training since he was 11. So he's been doing it a while. I started out at gym final round in Duncan. He's now fighting out of Black Box MMA in Duncan. And started competing in kickboxing when he was just 12 years old and fought a lot of older guys when he was 12 years old, Dave.
I mean, that's always a good experience, man. Just get in there, get some cage, some ring time, and then you're always gonna learn something.
Yeah, he was really disappointed. He was telling us this is his first fight of any kind since COVID. He was supposed to fight on a certain date in late March. COVID started 6 days earlier and it got canceled. So he was very disappointed.
Yeah, that's always frustrating when you're ready to get in there and then you're forced to just sit out. But what I liked about him is asking him what his, how would he describe your fighting style? Describe his fighting style, and he responded, aggressive. So that's always fun for the fans, somebody that brings the aggression.
Yeah, so he has a big background in jiu-jitsu and as well kickboxing, but he told us that he only did both of those so he could become a well-rounded mixed martial artist. And he would love a finish in this fight right now.
I saw Nesson relay. Little pocket. Harrison.
Yeah, I can't hear you. What's up?
I only saw your message.
All right, here's Harrison Woods coming to the cage. 19 years of age.
Harrison's going to.
Been training for 3 years. You see him there with his coach, Bibiano Fernandez.
He's the next fucking guy. Harrison's a fucking. He's a monster. He's a monster.
All right, he said any competition scenario, there's always nerves, but he's had so many jiu-jitsu competitions. He says keeping calm is the key.
I have Tristan screaming in my ear that this kid is a monster, absolute monster.
So you see there, extremely advanced in grappling. Like I said, only 19, a Brazilian jiu-jitsu brown belt. So we might see, Dave, a little bit of a grappling jiu-jitsu contest in this
one. Yeah, yeah. Tristan's been around a while, probably one of his coaches saying that he's an absolute monster. So it should be interesting to see how this one goes here. A little coming out party for one of these two fighters.
Yes, Harrison is a multiple-time open weight grappling champion just at 19 years of age. And both guys have a little slip as they come in for their MMA debuts here.
We got a little grease on the steps there. All right, wow, all right. Well, now I'm extra pumped for this one here. 19 years old.
All right, the BFL odds brought to you by Grindhouse Athletics, Vancouver's premier strength and conditioning facility. And it is Harrison Woods is the extreme favorite in this one. Look at these numbers, Dave. Woods is the 71% favorite. He has got the
submission edge for sure.
He's got the advantage in the striking.
Jeez.
Or rather, striking actually goes to Connor Sutton. Harrison Woods has the submission and wrestling advantage, and we don't know yet about their grit. All right, let's get these fighters introduced. Inside the cage we go. Here he is, Ryan Ventura.
Ladies and gentlemen, this next fight is in the BFL Super Welterweight Division, scheduled for three-minute rounds. Introducing first the fighter in the blue corner, making his BFL and MMA debut, representing Black Box MMA in Duncan, BC, here is Connor Sutton. And now introducing his opponent in the red corner, also making his BFL and MMA debut, this man is a multiple-time open-weight grappling champion. Representing En Garde Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu in Pitt Meadows and Revolution Martial Arts and Fitness in Langley, BC, here is Harrison Woods! And your man in charge of the action is Mitch Cadlick.
All right, Mitch Cadlick is the referee for this one, scheduled for three-minute rounds. This one in the Battlefield Amateur Super Welterweight Division. Is Connor Sutton in the red, Harrison Woods in the purple.
These guys look pretty eager to get in there. Oh, wow, this is going to be a good one. Oh, right, big overhand that lands right off the bat. And then, oh, looked like he was rocked there, but we know his strength is the grappling.
Yeah. We talked about the grappling of Harrison Woods, and he goes right for it. Ate a shot coming in, but
this is where he wants to be now. Improving to cross side, controlling the arm, heavy on top. See Sutton trying to defend there, doing okay going north-south. Woods is threatening the arm temporarily. Now he's just trying to establish position and way on top here. He's fine here, setting up shop, listening to his corner. You got Bibiato Fernandez there, and Coach Matt Kwan. So this is good for him, establishing side control, tiring him out. And he's gonna try and maybe attack a far arm, probably possibly improve to mount. Let's see here. Good start for Harrison Woods. Oh, nice knee on belly. That's good. Well, that's, oh, he's looking pretty strong here. Now he's progressing to mount here. Definitely seeming to have the advantage of having really heavy hips. He's taking his time. Notice the composure for such a young, a 19-year-old. There's a lot of composure for a first fight. You're taking his time attacking that far arm. He's gonna try and walk his left hand up to potentially set up an arm triangle, or now he's trying to push that wrist down, maybe attack an arm triangle Kimura, or Americana, excuse me, from this position here. You definitely see the edge in the grappling here. Just now full mount. Attacking the body, as this is their debut. They're not allowed to strike to the head. But now he's gonna try and possibly set up a triangle from the top here. He's thinking a whole bunch of submissions here as the young, oh, see, he was thinking triangle from the top here. But opts to just control the mount and just completely dominate from top here. Heavy hips, good posture. And now he's stretching out, he's using his feet. We call that the grapevine, stretching out his opponent's leg, so he's flat on his back, and now he can't even defend.
1 minute to go here in round number one. A good one so far for Harrison Woods.
Connor needs to buck him off. He needs to use his feet, put his heels to his butt, and buck him off here. But, oh, this is great for Woods. He's Now he's there's that triangle from the top we talked about, and now he's going to his back, and this might be it. Ooh, beautifully set up. He's controlling the far leg. Oh, this could be it. What a setup. Yeah, this is great. He's going to pull the head down. Most likely get the tap here.
Harrison Woods looking good. He's got 30 seconds left here in this round.
That was smooth like butter here. He's going to have to tap or nap.
You can see the head of Connor Sutton. A little bit of redness there in the forehead right now with all that pressure being applied by Harrison Woods.
Great toughness here by Connor here, not giving up. And then he's going to go back to the top because it wasn't quite
there.
This
could be a dangerous position now. He's got that triangle from the top now.
It's because Connor's arm is bent. It's not across his chin, so he's actually has a little pocket he's able to breathe there because he was able to withstand that. So that was a very good defense by Connor there,
all
and
right.
He gets away with it. Wow, great defense by Connor. He'll be happy with that. Wow.
We're going to go to round number two. He's going to be happy with the fact that he survived. I'm not sure if he's going to be happy with that round.
Yeah, he's looking pretty tired. Let's have a listen in here.
We need to get
corners.
That level change happen a little bit earlier. That double is sick, okay? If you can lock your hands under his butt, he's going down. Same strategy. But hey, he's not giving you the back because he knows you can't punch him in the face. So keep working your underhooks. Keep making him carry your weight.
If you get into the second time, hold his arm. Hold his arm. Don't put the leg and stretch his arm, okay? Stretch his arm. If you go lock like that, you stretch his arm. Everything will be so good, okay? Keep close now. Wait for time. Big breath, yeah. One more time. Is what you come back. See, you good position.
You get a triangle and there's 30 seconds left. We can think about switching to the armbar, okay? Let's go. Keep that head moving.
Some of the highlights here from the first round. That was right at the beginning of the round where Harrison Woods just walked through a couple of punches to get that takedown, and he was on top and in the dominant position for the rest of the round.
Yeah, great opening round here for young Harrison Wood.
And there you see Harrison Woods.
You know where he's going to try and take the fight. You can see his corner, Bibiano, telling him. Oh, nice stand. Oh, nice striking there.
Oh, some nice shots from Connor Sutton as Woods once again is just willing to absorb some things just to get in there and get to this position and get that takedown. And it took him about 15 seconds here, round number one, and about four shots as well.
Yeah, it's a price to pay. Luckily, he's got a chin on him. He's going to probably work on that as he evolves his game here. But he knows that if he gets it to the ground, he can pretty much do whatever he wants. Now he's got 2.5 minutes passing the legs, sliding his knee in there, going to side control once again. And now his opponent's got the cage, so he can't roll away. So Woods is going to be able to set up a lot of things here. Great control already, and he's just thinking of how to tire him out, possibly go knee on belly. And he learned a lot from that first round on the defense of his opponent here. And he almost got the tap. So now he's got a lot of time, 2 minutes, to set something up. Look at those heavy hips. And now he's just grinding his opponent, tiring him out. He's going to want
to. Now he's got the neon belly there.
Yeah, Sutton wants to turn to his own. Now, I think he's got thought about a guillotine for a second there. And then you see his corner, Matt Korn telling him he's telling him to go to mount, but he's got an arm on the far side there. He's going to try and attack a Kimura from the top. Oh, he may have it here. Oh, this is good for Woods. He's going to try and separate the wrist from the crotch area. That's the defense for Woods there. He's going to keep that hand right on his groin or to his belly, and Woods is going to try to separate it and bring that left arm to the back of his head, which is how he's going to get the tap here. But great defense. Good defense by Woods. He's getting a lot of subs, tricky subs thrown at him, and he's shown some good defense and composure. But it's still a really bad spot here for Woods. Now he's thinking.
Yeah, Harrison Woods once again in that dominant position here, same as round number one. It's almost like a little bit of a carbon copy.
Yeah, like you said in the pre-fight, the walkout there, he's multiple-time champion. He's got obviously a really strong ground game, which is on full display tonight. Look at those heavy hips. Once he's on top, like, he can pretty much do whatever he wants. It's just a matter of finding the right submission. But got to give it to Woods, though. He's shown some really good defense, and he's hanging in there. He's not giving up for sure.
30 seconds, Harrison.
Ooh. 20 seconds left for the young Woods. Content.
Yeah, Woods really heavy from that top position. Connor Sutton just not able to do anything to get out of this danger that he's been in for, again, the majority of round number two, just like round number one.
Yeah, he landed some great shots the very first 5 seconds, but then after that it was all Woods. He's gonna have to land those shots and then step off, circle off, and move the line, because Connor Woods will eat those to get that takedown, dominate the remaining, you know.
All right, quarter.
Let him open up a little bit.
Quarter camp brought to you by Grindhouse Athletics.
We've made him use his energy. What I want you to do is let him move a little bit so that we can get underhooks and stuff. Let him start framing and shrimping and bridging. Okay. And for God's sakes, be careful coming in, okay? Yeah. That's where we're eating some damage.
Don't let him turn. Let me point. Another thing is, when the top here, if you want to turn, let him turn. Let him give the back for you. You hear me? Another thing is, when the top, you lose a lot of weight. Come back a little bit. Yeah. Come back a little bit.
Here's the first
go try
5 seconds there.
Look at me.
Connor was able to land on my shots. And Woods ate rather well. And then got the takedown. And then dominated the rest of the round here. So he's threatening Kimura. Almost had it. But great defense.
All right, here we go, round number three. This one scheduled once again, 3 3-minute rounds. So far, this been all Harrison Woods.
Oh, there it is, nice shots!
Couple of
by
shots.
Connor, oh, those were heavy!
They were heavy.
Oh, he looked hurt
It's that 19-year-old chin.
Yeah.
But once again, he takes about 15 seconds to get him down.
Almost had him there. That was, wow. Every flurry got heavier and heavier. Those did some damage, definitely. But
Something for Harrison Woods moving forward is just
absolutely
working on his striking a little bit. But now look at him.
Hands up, chin down, because that could be the end of a fight there. But once it goes to the ground.
Absolutely. While it seems that Harrison Woods doesn't have a total defense for, you know, the striking of Connor Sutton, it's obvious Connor Sutton doesn't really have much of a defense for the takedown and then getting back to his feet
right.
In this fight as well.
Yeah, pretty much the tale of the tape. The story of this fight is five seconds of striking and the following 2.5 minutes of just grappling dominance by the young Harrison Woods. And then he's gonna want to get a finish here. So let's see if he's just clearing clearing the cobwebs, or he's gonna go for that finish. There you go. Passes the legs, chucks the legs to the side, passes to side control once again. And now he's thinking, how am I gonna finish this guy? Gonna try and get his knee on belly. Listening to his corner. Oh, nice pass to guard there. As his coach was telling him to knee the body, he just opted to...
Right into the mount at about the same time as round number two.
Yeah, he's going to want to try maybe catch an arm from here. Just like that. Notice his left arm. He's trying to get underneath his opponent's right elbow, walk that arm up and try to take that arm home. See what his opponent's giving him, but Woods has good submission defense, just not able to get him off of him. So Woods can just go from one attempt to another. And now he's looking
for the back there. Did he get it? No.
It's a back triangle.
Not quite.
Oh, nice sweep. Beautiful sweep by Woods into back and mouth. Wow, it's pretty. Look at that. Made that look like a warm up drill. Punishing the body. Wow. Great control. There's no quitting Woods, though. He's not giving him an inch there. It's a lot of submission attempts by Woods, and Sutton's not giving in. Look at those heavy hips for a 19-year-old.
Yeah, final 15 seconds here in the fight.
See if he tries to one more attempt here.
A fight that really has been dominated by Harrison Woods, the 19-year-old.
Yeah, great dominance. Good defense for Sutton there, but definitely he's going to be happy with that performance right now for the young 19-year-old Harrison Woods. Yeah, both guys pretty tired. I mean, it's a lot of action. A lot of submission attempts. Going to be happy with that. Great experience. 3 full rounds in the first fight. Fought through some adversity, took some heavy shots. Definitely something we'll be talking about in the in the training room. But good chin shown by the young Woods.
Yeah, he
he took those like a champ.
The striking absolutely went to Connor Sutton. It's for Connor Sutton. It's just too bad it was only 5 seconds at the beginning of each round.
It's like he knew he could land a couple shots, so they kept getting harder and harder. First round, second round, and third round. Those were some bombs. Those looked like he almost, he flashed KO'd him for a second there. You could tell he was hurt. But then once it goes to the ground, it's automatic, back to the basics, and grappling is in his blood there. Looked great. Looked great on the ground.
All right, for the second fight to kick off PFL 74, we are going to go to the judges' scorecards.
Once again, two for two.
You see Connor Sutton there, and
look at this.
Some of the highlights.
Oh, that one! Oh, man,
couple
that
of big
one!
Right,
that one!
Three right hands that landed not Woo. Quite on the button, but very close.
Those were buttons if I ever saw one. Those were clean on the chin. Most guys would have been knocked out after two. He took three straight ones. That definitely rocked him, shook him a little bit. But he
it's that 19-year-old chin, I guess.
Damn. Like, wow. Those were solid.
All right.
Look at that sweep.
This decision wow. brought to you by Red One Casting, Canada's number one casting company. Inside the cage we go, and here he is with the decision, Ryan Ventura.
Ladies and gentlemen, after three rounds, we go to the judge's decision. Judge number one scored the fight 30-27. Judge number two scored the fight 30-27. And judge number three scored the fight 29-28 for your winner by unanimous decision. The fighter in the red corner, Harrison Woods.
Harrison Woods is your winner. And Dave, the one big decision was one of the judges gave one of the rounds to Connor Sutton. Which round do you think that was? Maybe the third
no,
round?
No, that was unanimous.
Was it was one was 29-28. It was unanimous, but one was 29-28.
Jeez, I don't know. I don't know.
So maybe it was based on those big shots at the beginning of round number three. They thought that was more...
Sure, I mean, in terms of damage, but I mean, that's still 10 seconds, and the round is, you know, 3 minutes, so I don't know. I'm not a judge, but that was a great performance for the young Harrison Woods. Good job, buddy.
All right, moving right along. Fight number three on the undercard here at BFL 74. As we await the appearance of another Connor, this time Connor Monahan, and there he is. Young man fighting out of Unity MMA in Vernon. This is his second BFL fight. Quite an unorthodox striker, and he is currently the sixth ranked amateur featherweight here in BFL. Had a tough one go, his tough go last out. Was he lost the split decision to Cena Manny. That was back in December, a tough go last time out. 23 years of age, training for about 3 years. Used to watch the UFC with his buddies. The fight that really got him into it was GSP versus Bisping. And like we just mentioned, that split decision loss, it was close against Cena Manny, who we are going to see later tonight on the first fight of our main card portion of BFL 74.
That's right. Bisping versus versus GSP, man, that ever make you feel old? That wasn't that long ago. That was his comeback fight.
Now back to that fight with Cena Manny.
Yeah.
He thought, or this man here, Connor Monahan, thought it wasn't even close. He thought he had easily won that fight. Judges didn't give it to him, so it didn't go his way, and there you go.
That's always annoying. That's why they say time and time again, don't ever leave it in the hands of the judges, because you never know what they're gonna do. Finish your fights, kids.
Absolutely. Now, he's been working a lot on the ground game, on the wrestling.
Look at the frame on this guy. He is long and lanky, man.
He just totally enjoys the striking more.
Yeah, I would say. Look at his body type, man.
Yeah, like, don't be surprised if he comes out throwing kicks and punches.
That's right. Kicks and punches against the BJJ brown belt. And Tage Castonguay, second BFL fight. With our pal Jamie Siraj in his corner there, rocking his shirt. Gremlin.
Last fight out, back in July, it was a unanimous decision win over Nelson Spru. Since then, Tage has been working on his wrestling. He feels he's trying to get to the point where he's well-rounded, adaptable. He wants his adjustments to be great. His base, though, is striking and kickboxing, so That being the case, we might see a little bit of stand-up here, maybe a little bit more than our last fight that we saw.
Yeah, both guys seem to enjoy their striking, so this should be an exciting one here. Although he is a brown belt, so if it goes to the mat, you know, he's not afraid to go there. But sometimes when you get rocked, you go back to your roots. So it'll be interesting to see where this fight goes. Asked him what were his thoughts on his opponent. He says he seems okay, doesn't know much about him. Seems like a stand-up guy, long and rangy, as we can tell just by his body type. And, you know, he learned a lot from his first fight. One thing he taught himself was it's very, very important to stay calm in there. And it's not as intimidating as he thought. Once you get in there, their first fight, you get so many crazy thoughts in your head after you've been in there and things go okay. You can be like, oh, wow, it's not as scary as you may think, right? So see here, he's the fourth ranked amateur featherweight currently. He's well-rounded. And as we mentioned, he's a BJJ brown belt. So another good matchup here as we approach our third fight of our undercard here.
Yeah, it should be interesting to see if Tage can get inside on Connor Monahan, who's definitely going to have the height and reach advantage.
Yeah, and to see if possibly he does want to take him down and test that brown belt. Who knows? We are about to find out.
Let's go, Tage!
Good song he's got going here. That's a walkout song.
All right, Tage Castengay. His entrance into the cage. All right, the BFL odds brought to you by Grindhouse Athletics, Vancouver's premier strength and conditioning facility. It is Castengay with the 58-42 overall advantage. Monahan with the slight edge in striking. Submissions going to Castengay, as well as the wrestling and the grit. All right, well, let's get these fighters introduced. Inside the cage we go. Here he is, our cage announcer, Ryan Ventura.
Ladies and gentlemen, this next fight is in the BFL featherweight division, scheduled for three-minute rounds. Introducing first the fighter in the blue corner. This man has a record of no wins, one loss, making his second BFL appearance. Representing Unity MMA in Burnie, BC, here is Connor Monahan. And now introducing his opponent in the red corner. This BJJ brown belt has a record of one win, no losses. Also making his second BFL appearance. Representing Revolution Martial Arts and Fitness in Langley, BC, he's your current number four ranked BFL amateur featherweight fighter. Here is Tage Castengay. And your man in charge of the action is John Cooper.
All right, John Cooper is our referee for this one, Dave, as we get set for three-minute rounds in the featherweight division here at Battlefield's amateur ranks. It is Monahan. He's in the black with red. Castengay is in the purple with white.
Monahan with the white gloves. Tage with the blacks.
We'll see what Monahan does to come out here, Dave. Is he going to try and keep that distance, use that length?
Yeah, it looks like he's got that Muay Thai stance upright, but he definitely is he's very long and trying to keep that distance, but nice work by Cage to close that distance, and it looks like he's going to try and take it down here. Nice attempt. He's got the back. He's going to get it. And tossed around. Good defense by Monahan. But then Tage gets that one hook, but great work by Monahan shaking him off. He's got those long arms.
Yeah, Castengay relentless here early in round number one, trying to get that takedown, doesn't quite have it yet.
He's working for it, he's trapping that forearm, he's got his arms together, if he could just pick him up, but he's got the cage. There it is, nice work by Tage to get it. And then Monahan using the cage to try and roll off, but oh, and he does. Good
back
job.
To his feet momentarily anyways.
Nice work by Tage to stay on him. Gets one hook in. Very nice. Like a backpack. Sticks to him. And now this is great for Tage. He worked for it. He earned that back take. One hook in. And he's not going to want to lose that after exerting that much effort to get it.
This is not where Connor Monahan wants to be right now. I'm sure he'd rather be on his feet just trading away.
Tage got his second hook in there. It's kind of an awkward position because his head's on the ground. He's trying to shake him off. But he's got two hooks in there. And then awkwardly against a cage here. This is very weird position.
But is Monahan going to be able to shake him off?
He does.
He does.
Great work by Monahan. He didn't stop moving. He just kept trying to move and get him off him, and it worked. Now he's on top, and Tage is stuck against the cage here. This is good for Monahan. Now he's trying to wrap his legs, progress to a better position. Good work by Monahan on top. Tage, great job going, yeah, getting to his knees and getting back up to his feet. Gets the back here. He's going to try and do the same thing. Take that far leg and sweep him down.
Yeah, relentless work by Tage.
Notice how he traps his arm. He's got his hands together, and he's trapping Monahan's arm. So if he can just go to that side, he can't posture. And he switches to a single leg right here in front of us. Great defense by Monahan. Those long limbs are stable.
Yeah, he spreads out those long limbs, and yeah, it's tough for him to get a double double leg.
Good. Got the knee there, protect, keep him to a distance. It's not making it easy for Tage to get the takedown. A lot of back and forth here. Monahan slides the knee in there. Nice little knee to the body. You can see Tage's corner telling him that we live here. So obviously, yeah, they've been drilling this. Good Tage, control. He's got the hands together.
Tage constantly thinking about getting those hooks in.
Relentless.
Oh, big right hand from Monahan lands as Tage goes back just a little bit here.
Yeah, that was nice.
Final 10 seconds. Oh, nice left hand from Tage Castengay.
Relentless. Relentless takedown attempt.
All right, we're going to listen to what the corners have to say after this round number one. The corner cam brought to you by Grindhouse Athletics, Vancouver's premier strength and conditioning facility. Let's have a listen.
Fucking beautiful. All the work on the cage. Okay? I don't want you to be in a rush to jump up. Keep the body lock, drag him down. When you get behind him and that trip isn't working, I want you to redirect and I want you to block his knee and take him the other way. If you're tripping him here, get behind his knee, put them back. Okay? Off the break, if you see a shot, nothing fancy. Hit him with a fucking left hand right hook. Keep it simple. No fancy kicks off the break there. That's what's on the ground. Okay? Keep warmed up.
This is nothing. You're not even sweating.
Okay.
Get some water.
Back and forth round, pretty good from Tage Castengay, Dave.
That was pretty good for both guys because he was relentless with the takedown offense, and then Monahan never let up off the defense and never really allowed him to get, you know, too comfortable in there. So didn't take any damage, and both guys probably equal amount of tired here. And I think we'll see Monahan try and keep that distance and use those long limbs and keep him at bay and land some striking. And I think the game plan for Tage is going to try and close that distance and secure a takedown and actually control it, because he hasn't been able to do that quite yet. Very close first round.
Kick to the body, both gentlemen trying to kick there.
Nice
side kick from Tage.
Nice cross that lands by Tage there. Good use of the kicks for
Kick from Monahan.
Mixing it up. Nice. I like the fakes, but Connor's pretty loose in there, offering a few different looks and different fakes. Staying at bay.
That left hand from Monahan, just a little bit low.
Very low, but that could be part of his strategy to lure in Tage, knowing that he's actually at a striking distance disadvantage.
Nice kick that landed the body of Monahan there.
He's so long, he knows that. Oh, nice. Partial slip kick, but nevertheless.
Oh, nice. See, Tage comes out with that left hand that lands as he's trying to get out of a little bit of trouble there.
Kick to the hand. About the same amount of output from both fighters, mixing it up with the punches and kicks for both guys.
Body shot from Castengay. And now it's Monahan looking for the takedown.
Yeah,
switches from the double to the single.
Didn't see that one coming. He did a good job closing that distance. He may have it here. Oh, and he trapped. Now he should have it here as he crossed his hand around the hips. Great takedown by Monahan.
Nice double leg. It's Monahan in top position. Different from round number one.
Yeah, controlling the legs there. Tage is going to try and posture up. Joe thinking to possibly guillotine. Using the cage. Get up. Monahan puts him back down. He's got to have to watch out for his neck here. Tage is thinking possible guillotine if he can clasp his hands together. Ooh, looks like he's got a neck here.
Does he have something there? Is it tight enough? No, not quite.
Good defense.
Cassin Gay had to let go there.
Yeah. Good defense, but still.
Now he's looking for it again, possibly.
Oh, using it.
Nice sweep.
Use it for almost a sweep to the top, to the mount. And now Hages takes his back here. So we got 20 seconds left in the second round. Very even, another even round. Now.
Final few seconds here, round number two. Another pretty even round between both these fighters.
Yeah, these are some great matchups so far tonight. So you go either way. Hard fought rounds here.
Let's have a look back at some of the replays here. That was that push kick where Castanier seemed to kind of slip there a little bit. And this is Monahan looking for that double leg, which he would eventually get. A nice sweep. Nice sweep from Castanegay there as we go back to listen into the corners.
Okay. If you want the takedown, okay, fucking commit to the knee block or the trip. If not, give me some dirty off the break now, okay?
Don't be frustrated. You're doing good. You just need to add a little more volume, it's going to be better. Single shots, you can land them. The combos, you're going to get them, bro. You're going to put them out, okay? You got this, dog.
Okay, I love that left kick to the body. Now he knows the left kick to the body coming. Next time you do the gate, blast that fucking knee. Okay. Let's go, baby.
I mean, I'm going to say it. We sound like a broken record, but it's going to come down to this third round.
There's a very good chance, yeah. Absolutely.
Are we going to see another decision? Or is somebody going to finish this thing? Both guys looking about equal amounts of tired. Both guys. Good shape. Bringing it. Not afraid to engage. Just a great, like, even fight so far. A little bit of everything. Nice striking. Good battle on the ground. Good job mixing it up here. Oh, nice body kick by Monahan there. Does a good job utilizing his reach and keeping Tage on the end of his strikes.
Yeah, for the first time, really, he's starting to be a little bit more successful as he misses a couple of shots.
The second, and it's going to come down to the final minute. If Tage could get a takedown, that'd be great. But Connor's not making it easy on him. Still landing some nice reverse punches while Tage is on his back here. Very close fight.
It's a little bit of a different Tage Castanegay in this round.
He's a little tired.
Yeah. Both fighters tired, I think, at this point, Dave.
But the volume, Connor is landing the shots consistently. Not crazy powerful shots, but he's just throwing everything. Little elbows, reverse punches, little knees, teeps, kicks. In terms of striking volumes, he's definitely doing a great job just not laying off the striking pedal.
All right, we're in the final minutes here in our third and final round.
Notice.
And you're right, Monahan is
a lot.
He's sneaking in a lot of those
punch,
knees
punch, punch.
And those punches to the body.
A little bit of everything. He's getting his hips back, landing some knees, and his corner's loving it. They know that those add up. Little punches. Great defense. And able to throw strikes and not get taken down takes a lot of, you know, good defense and balance and stability, because often people will throw a couple punches and end up on their back, so it's all for nothing. But he's staying on his feet, and he literally the last, you know, minute and a half, he's been defending the takedown extremely well and landed nonstop strikes, a little bit of everything. Punches, knees, like, he's doing a great job for someone fighting with his back to the cage here. Look at those knees.
All right, final 10 seconds here, and they separate. We'll see what happens here. Spinning heel kick there, attempt from Monahan. And that's it, Dave. We're going to the judges' scorecard for the third time in a row to begin tonight's action. Wow.
What a fight. Judges are gonna have a busy night. Honestly, that's another close one. Great fight, guys. Awesome.
Yeah, good back and forth contest.
Yeah, definitely.
Got to think that third might have gone to Monahan.
I mean, yeah. I mean,
and
I'll go with that.
The first maybe to Tage, and then what happened in that second round? Is that what it's going to come down to in this one? Is it possibly this man here, Tage Castengay?
I'm going to say if it comes down to the third, that's where I'm going. But luckily, unofficial decision. We're not the judges. You never know. Could be a draw. Could go either way. It's not our job, but that was fun to watch for sure.
So we just await the judges tallying up their scores.
I'd love to see a strike count. Let's see if we can.
Tage Castengay right there. Seems pretty happy with his performance.
That is a tall guy.
All right, to the judges' scorecards we go. This decision brought to you by Red One Casting, Canada's number one sports casting company. And let's find out where the judges went with this one. Dave, inside the cage we go. Here he is, Ryan Ventura.
Ladies and gentlemen, after three rounds, we go to the judges' decision. Judge number one has scored the fight 29-28, blue. Judge number two has scored the fight 29-28, red. And judge number three has scored the fight 30-27 for your winner by split decision, the fighter in the blue corner, Connor Monahan.
There we go. Close.
All right, so obviously the what Connor Monahan did in the fight, that appealed more to the judges in that one. Some excellent striking. I think as the fight wore on, his striking, I think, found a little bit more of a home, definitely in that third round.
Just volume,
sure.
Just volume. Yeah. I'd say sheer volume was kind of the differentiating factor there. We both thought it went one way. It could have been either way, but that's going to be a good habit. You know, when things are close, just keep throwing strikes, and things like that can happen. But great guys, great fight by both gentlemen. Awesome. And hopefully we'll see them again in the cage very soon.
All right, we'll remind everybody once again that just over a half hour's time at 7:30 Pacific, 10:30 Eastern, we are going to switch to UFC Fight Pass for the main card of BFL 74. We've got our champ, Dan Kajic. He is in action, as well as former UFC fighter Tristan Connolly. He's going to make his reappearance in the BFL cage tonight. All right. We're going to get to our last fight of the main, of the rather the undercard. This is Ethan McKenna fighting for the third time in the Battlefield promotion. Ethan McKenna fighting out of Martial Arts Unlimited Kickboxing in Victoria, British Columbia. Last kickboxing fight was back in February, won a unanimous decision. That was in a different promotion. Fought once in MMA, that was all the way back in 2018. I think he might be a little bit more interested in kickboxing. And Dave, he's been kickboxing for quite a while.
How long?
Been doing it since he was 14. He's now 25 years of age, so 11 years. Doing karate since he was four. Then he transitioned to kickboxing. And he said karate was great for him as a kid. Says it just kept him out of trouble.
Yeah, it's great. You know, martial arts is great for kids. Karate, jiu-jitsu, anything at a young age when it comes to martial arts is always a good habit to have. And then now, MMA has just become so popular that it's hard not to want to try and get in there and give it a go. And get addicted to it, which is great for us. And then this is kickboxing. Mixing things up a little bit.
Yeah, so we are, this one will be scheduled for 3 2-minute rounds.
And Ethan really feels that the timing that he's developed in karate really translates well into kickboxing. I think that's one of his biggest strengths is the timing. He developed all those years of karate, bringing it to kickboxing, and that's what he feels like he's going to have. He doesn't know much about his opponent because there's not much footage on him, but that's what he feels is going to be able to set himself apart here.
Yeah, it says he's a little bit unorthodox.
Should be another fun one here.
Yeah, we'll see if the unorthodox thing is a difference in this fight. Doesn't know much, like you said, about Jamil, except the fact that Jamil hasn't actually fought in a little while. But Jamil brings in a perfect 4-0 record. And look at Jamil Hosani walk in. This is his second BFL appearance.
Training out at WKX here. You can see his posse in the back. Jay Johnsey. Papa Johnsey. Jamil is 30. He's asked him, when did you start training? And his answer was, he's been training his whole life, so he's pretty well prepared. He's excited to get in there, and he said it's his first fight after a 7-year layoff, which is ridiculous. Even Josh Johnson is in the house, the whole family. And I asked him, well, what made you come back? He's like, you know what? It's just time. He's just gave it the time it needed, trusted the process. Here he is. He's feeling like the right time. He's a personal trainer. That explains his jacked physique. And he's just really pumped to get in there and entertain the fans.
Yeah, and he says he's a Dutch-style kickboxer, which is aggressive. He's got some choppy kicks. Doesn't know much about his opponent. Stands across from him in the cage.
He mentioned earlier about the mental, and he's like, he had some time off, and he's like, that was the biggest thing. He's trying to get his mind back into the best shape possible. As we know, the mental side of fighting is extremely important that a lot of people overlook or just don't quite realize the importance of, as you can hear him getting the love from the fans.
All right, the BFL odds brought to you in this fight by Grindhouse Athletics, Vancouver's premier strength and conditioning facility. It is Hosseini is the underdog to McKenna, 52-48, and we'll see if that plays out in this fight. All right, time to get these fighters introduced. Inside the cage we go. Here he is, Ryan Ventura.
Ladies and gentlemen, this next fight is a 155-pound kickboxing match scheduled for 3 2-minute rounds. Introducing first the fighter in the blue corner. This man has a record of 4 wins, 1 loss. Making his 3rd BFL appearance. Representing Martial Arts Unlimited Kickboxing in Victoria, BC, here is Ethan McKenna. And now introducing his opponent in the red corner. This man has a perfect record of 4 wins, no losses. Making his 2nd BFL appearance. Representing WKX in Surrey, BC, here is Jamil Hosseini. And your man in charge of the action is Mitch Cadlick.
All right, Mitch Cadlick is the referee. This one once again scheduled for 3 2-minute rounds. A couple of kickboxers going at it. And we've got Jamil Hosseini. He is wearing the black with red and white trim. Ethan McKenna, he is in the black with silver and yellow.
Let's go. This one looks like a fun one.
All right, we'll see. Well, McKenna's going to have the size and reach here in this one.
Jesus.
You look at Jamil, though. That guy's built.
He's a tank. Built like a tank, man. Let's see who lands. Ooh, that uppercut just misses. Definitely it seems to have a little bit of power. Oh, nice head kick! It almost knocks him out! Holy crap! What happened? Standing 10 count, head kick, almost knockout. That landed. I saw that was shin to the head, rocked him. Great job by the referee, because this is kickboxing rules. I was legit knocked down. I saw it, he was rocked. And natural instinct is to act like you're not, but no, he took that one like a champ. Wow.
Yeah, I wondered if it was that comeback where it hit him on the back of the head.
No, it was shin to the side of the head. That was clean if we see the replay later. Nice kick, great distance kick by McKenna. That was beautiful. Unfortunately, shot by Jamil.
That right hand landed on McKenna, and that hurt him. That made him stagger back a little bit.
A little bit of blood
from the right eye of Jamil.
Possibly from that kick. Man, he's coming. He's hungry. Wow. Man, no time waste. That's only 1 minute in. If that was MMA, McKenna could have pounced on him, but lucky for us, it's going to last a bit longer. Oh, just tries that head kick again, but this time
Zuko got out of the way.
Wow. That was a beautiful head kick. Look at that nice check kick by McKenna there. He looks very loose and has great distance control there as he knows he's a bit longer. But strong, good power by Jamil, who's just coming in. Some heavy shots, nice kick by
Jamil. Yeah, some of those high kicks from McKenna starting to find a little bit of a home. They're blocked partially, but
McKenna's doing a great job just staying a distance, being long, long kicks, long punches. So just out of range from Jamil's power shots. Obviously, he doesn't want those landing. And Jamil's trying to, oh, nice.
Oh, another nice high kick lands. And then a push kick lands to the belly.
Very.
Just sort of seemed like it made Jamil mad, though, as he comes in with that
still those landed. Nice spinning kick by Jamil, but great smoothness by McKenna there, looking very relaxed in there. Great composure and landing some very nice shots, tricky shots, question mark kicks. Man, that head kick was beautiful. Right on the temple.
All right, we're going to have a listen into the quarters.
Listen, that was a good round. Yeah, we had a little thing, but it's going to come back. We're going to get something back. You have to stay calm, okay? You have to stay calm. Don't get over-anxious like you want to knock his head off. We're going to knock his head off. So we've got to set it up first. Otherwise, we're going to swing and miss.
All right, let's see if you can see the kick. Oh, right there, see? That's what cut him, sliced him. Boom, clean.
Oh, yeah, see, and that's where I thought it might have actually come back in the heel. It hit him in the back of the head.
Oh, that was very nice, beautiful, and actually you can see that's a nasty cut. He, like, sliced him open there. But great exchange by both guys, but that was definitely the most significant shot and damage that sliced him right open there. And rocked him, visibly rocked him and dropped him. So great, great opening round for specifically McKenna, but both guys showing some skill in there. Wow, that was awesome. What's up? Time now. He's gonna maybe get the doctor to check out that cut. Although they did a good job cleaning it up. Come on.
Okay, we're set for round number two.
Wow.
Just a slight interruption there, we're ready to go.
What a first round here. All right, so. Got Jamil trying to cut the distance, coming with those power shots. We got McKenna, that little Muay Thai stance, doing a good job. Ooh. Keeping the distance and landing shots at distance. So good defense here. Good kick by Jamil. A nice in and out. In and out movement by McKenna in combination.
Yeah, kick, punch, and then out from McKenna.
He's more unpredictable in his movement there. Both guys packing a lot of power. See Jamil just trying to set up that big overhand there as he lands a lead hook there. Nice. Strong kicks by Jamil. A lot was blocked there. It's still, you can see the damage adding up there on the left leg of McKenna. Both guys just trying to find a hole here.
Oh, Superman punch from Jamil.
He's fast. Oh, right to the south of the border.
Yeah, with 47 seconds left to go, I think we're going to take a little pause here.
Fortunate. Gives him time for a little breather. Straight push kick to the junk, unfortunately.
Ethan McKenna not happy about exactly this right here, that push right out. It's never intended, it's just gonna take some time. Unfortunately, McKenna starting to look like he might be back, ready to go, and here he is.
Nice counter shots by McKenna.
Yeah, you just see Hosseini just stalking McKenna, but McKenna with those counters, and he's moving around and using the whole cage quite nicely here. That high kick almost lands, partially blocked here.
Yeah, he does a really nice job throwing accurate strikes while he's moving backwards. Which takes the time to develop that skill. Nice spinning
technique from McKenna. Yeah, goes up high with that heel. Those could be dangerous. Final 10 seconds. You see that blood coming again from the the right eye of Jamil Hosseini. Good push kick from McKenna. Another push kick, and then they end the round. And Jamil almost just kicked, took a look at him for a second, said, I'm not terribly happy with the way that ended.
Yeah, that was a crazy round. Let's have a look at the replay here. You can see here. Whoa, great head movement by Jamil, ducking under and landing that lead hook. He's got that little Tyson-esque little, you know, short and stocky coming in, very hard to find
using
his head.
Yeah, using his legs
very
to
powerful.
Kind of get up and punch and strike.
Yeah, and his strikes are obviously quite powerful. You can tell by his build and by what he's thrown, but hard to punch. Very close second round there. That was a good one. Both guys have moments in there.
Okay.
All right, into the corners we go.
Move, jab, go, jab, move, move, move. Just making mistakes and you're getting that high kick.
Wow, this is a fun kickboxing fight. Final third round once again. Here we go. Might be the theme of the evening. A lot of decisions. Let's see if this one can last another 2 minutes here. Both guys ready to throw down. Third and final round.
Yep, final 2 minutes. Here we go.
Which has been a great back and forth fight. A little bit of everything. Oh, nice. Nice hook again. It lands by Jamil. Nice head movement. Oh,
some big shots landed by Jamil.
Very
and then
nice.
A right.
Very nice sequence by Jamil.
McKenna gets back up, though.
Bobbing and weaving with that little head movement we talked about. And then was able to land
there,
some good
and
shots.
And there you saw the power, the danger, the power of Jamil Hosseini.
Nice. But great composure by McKenna, who's not phased, still going backwards, still landing great shots, punches and kicks. Great output. Just, you can definitely see that little, that's very old. You gotta be careful. Don't wanna put those hands down. But definitely a lot of power from Jamil's side.
Yeah, look at the redness on the chest of Jamil with those front kicks from McKenna. You can see that redness there.
You can see the confidence building for Jamil there, but you want to stay focused here. With 1 minute left, this is anyone's fight.
Confidence or desperation, we'll see.
You don't want to
Jamil's getting a little frustrated, too.
McKenna might throw another head kick to him. Oh, nice. Shot for shot. Mixing it up. Punch for kick. Jamil just stalking him down, trying to cut off the cage here and land something. Nice kick. Nice jab by McKenna. Still very even fight here. Jamil just looking to set up that power shot, but be getting frustrated because great movement by McKenna. He's not phased at all. He's doing what he's supposed to do. Keep the distance, keep landing those shots. Let's see here, final 25 seconds. Anyone's fight. Nice body kick and then great job by Jamil catching it. Good balance by McKenna, not getting swept. Nice shot by Jamil.
Big right hand from Jamil. That kind of half Superman and left hand. Spinning back technique from Jamil. Finishing strong here.
He's a
now he's
man.
Stalking around. He's stalking McKenna. He looks to land the lefty uppercut. What a great finish to that fight.
What a flurry, sorry. What a flurry to end the fight. What a flurry.
And you just had the idea in the last minute and a half of that fight, maybe the whole last round, actually, Jamil Hosseini just was the predator.
Yeah, he was just, his confidence was building and building because he was becoming the aggressor. But, I mean, yeah, that last flirt was pretty great. That last 30 seconds, that was a great fight. Very, very close. Another close decision. All right, let's see. As we said in the second round, like that little head movement, ducks under, that hook, and then spinning kick to a spinning back fist. Mixing it up nicely is Jamil here. Coming in, hands down, full of blood. Just ready. See there, his hands up, is ducking his head is very hard to hit, and he landed some great shots. This is the final feeler of that hook.
That left hook landed,
yeah, that was nice. That was probably his most damaging shot, was that lead hook. Good job mixing it up there in the third round for Jamil. We'll see if that's enough to give him the victory here, which has been, which was a very entertaining kickboxing fight. It's a little bit of everything there. Too bad that wasn't five rounds. Nice little cut. I'll need a few stitches there. Lucky for us, that wasn't the end of the fight.
Yeah, you'd have to see the damage went the way of McKenna.
Well, I mean, yeah, he sliced him open.
But we'll see
almost knocked him out with a head kick. I'll give him that one.
We'll see if that See if that plays a part in the judges' decision. Four in a row on the undercard tonight get decided by the judges.
Both guys are 4-0, right? I believe someone's always got to go.
All right, this decision brought to you by Red One Casting, Canada's number one sports casting company. And for the official judges' decision, inside the cage we go. Here is our cage announcer, Ryan Ventura.
Ladies and gentlemen, after three rounds, we go to the judges' scorecard. Judge number one has scored the fight 28-28. Judge number two has scored the fight 29-27, blue. And judge number three has scored the fight 28-28 for a majority draw.
Oh! No way! No way!
A majority draw!
The winners are the fans. That is very frustrating as a fighter, but hey, that was fun to watch and great experience for both guys. They both showed some great skill, heart, and determination there, and a little bit of everything there. That was awesome.
All right, coming up in 20 minutes, please make sure to join us on UFC Fight Pass for the main card of BFL 74. Man, what a card, Dave, we have in store. The main event is for the Super Welterweight Championship. We have got the champion, Dan Kyach. He is going up against the contender, JC Jamis. He is amazing. And then the co-main event, the champion in the featherweight division, Mateo Vogel, takes on Taylor Christopher, who hasn't lost 9 years. Make sure you join us, 7:30 Pacific.